and today I'll be taking your class on infertility. To be specific, because infertility is a wide subject, we are going to deal with cervical and uterine factors of infertility specifically today. So as we know, what is infertility? Infertility, when a woman of reproductive age group is not being able to conceive even after 1 year of regular and unprotected intercourse, and the incidence is almost 15%. Out of this 15%, 1/3 are because of the male factor, 1/3 are because of the female factor, and the rest of the 1/3 are because of the both the factors combined. Then remains 10%, that is 30-30-30, and 10% where both the partners are normal but it is a idiopathic type of infertility. But if the woman's age is beyond 35 years of not being able to conceive even after 6 months of regular unprotected intercourse, we can start her investigations. Now, how does a pregnancy? The pregnancy is a result of a chain of events. A woman must first ovulate an ovum from one of her ovaries. The ovum pickup will be there from the femoral end of the fallopian tube, and then the ovum must travel through the fallopian tube towards the uterus. The sperm must fertilize the ovum along the way, and the fertilized egg must then become implanted. So the fertilized egg must then become implanted inside the uterus. So this is a picture showing the common causes of female infertility. Out of this, we can see that almost 10% are because of the uterine factors, 5% because of cervical factors, 30-40% are the ovarian factors, tubal factor is 25-35%, and other pelvic causes are also there. Out of the cervical factors, if you go from down upwards, can be because of infection, infective sperm penetration is there, then chronic cervicitis, immunological factors where there is presence of anti-sperm antibodies, the uterine factors like the unfavorable endometrium, chronic endometritis, especially like tuberculosis, synecdoche formation as in Asherman syndrome, and then the congenital malformations of fibroids. In the ovulatory causes, there are the anovulation, especially like the PCOS, and in this the corpus luteum or the LPD, that is the corpus luteum deficiency. Then comes a tubal factor, which can be, there may be blockage of the tube or infection of the tube leading to blockage following tubal infections or endometriosis, 25-35%, and other causes like the pelvic causes or peritoneal causes would be endometriosis or adhesions. So again, this is a more specific type of causes where it describes the reproductive tract development. Now we coming to the cervical causes. The cervical causes of infertility accounts for almost 5% of the total causes of infertility, and because cervix must capture, filter, nurture and release the sperms into the uterus and then into the fallopian tube in order to conceive. The cervix usually points towards the posterior fornix so that the following ejaculation, the external os is immersed in the seminal pool. And any cervical alteration occurs in the diameter or external os, and canal or isthmus being the widest at the ovulation for passage of sperms and spermatozoa. Cervical causes source can be the cervical stenosis, the chronic cervicitis, fibroids in the cervix, trauma to the cervix, anatomical causes or immunological causes. Stenosis can cause because partial or complete obstruction. It impacts the natural fertility by impeding the passage of the sperms into the uterus, and the stenosis of the cervical os or cervical canal as a sequelae of the electrocautery, cryotherapy, conization, amputation of the cervix, and it affects the sperm antigens also. Cervicitis is an important cause because the cervical mucus becomes impenetrable by the sperms and promotes the sperm destruction by the influx of vaginal bacteria. Anatomical causes can be abnormal position of the cervix, or it can be hypoplastic cervix, or it can be hypertrophied cervix. There can be trauma to the cervix because of the conization of the cauterization. Then synecdoche in the cervical canal as a result of the postpartum and postnatal curettage. Repeated curettage can also cause this, and fibroids that will change the shape and it will cause the stenosis of the cervix. There can be immunological causes in the cervix also, like the anti-sperm antibodies, 10-20% may be there, like the IgG, IgM or IgA type of immunoglobulins. They kill the sperms as soon as it enters, and so it acts as an anti-sperm. then cervical mucus accepts the captures the sperm. It's that is the normal action of it from the ejaculate. Now the prolongs the sperm survival and fertile interval between the intercourse and the ovulation. So the estrogen stimulates the cervical mucus production, and mucus becomes more watery, less cellular, and more easily penetrable by the sperms. Whereas progesterone inhibits the cervical mucus production and renders it viscid and impenetrable by the sperms. So how do we evaluate by the cervical mucus? Like, one is by the history. Careful review of the past gynecological history should be taken of any operations in the cervix, and also any past obstetric history of forceps or operative deliveries. Then cervical examination should be done. So we have to do a PV examination and perispeculum examination to see any infection or any abnormality in the anatomy. Then the probing of the cervix can be determined by the length and course of the canal and presence of synecdoche or the growths. Then diagnosis for the cervical mucus is by the PCT, that is a postcoital test, which is the most essential diagnostic test, and this is done at few to several hours after intercourse. It can be done between 2 to 12 hours. So we ask the patient to come after, immediately after the intercourse in the morning, and then we collect the collection of the cervical mucus is done by an aspirate from the nasal polyp forceps and shortly before expected time of ovulation. Then the routine use of the PCT for investigation and fertile problems is not recommended, because it is has no predictive value on pregnancy rate. The PCT test result, it will be normal if the normal amount of sperms are seen in the sample. Sperms are moving forward in the cervical mucus and they are not dead, and mucus stretches at least 2 cm, that is the spin bucket, and mucus dries like a, when you dry it on the slide, it forms a fern like pattern. If it is abnormal, it does not stretch, then it does not dry in the fern like pattern, there are no sperms or a large number of dead sperms are seen because of the anti-sperm antibodies, and the sperms are clumped together, that means it is an abnormal result. And treatment is, if it is a stricture, dilatation, stenosis, gentle dilatation, synecdoche can be broken by DNC, but no forcible dilatation should be there, otherwise you make a false passage. And suspected infection, then you give a culture, do culture sensitivity, and follow by the course of antibiotics. Then we come to the uterine factors of infertility. The sole cause is about 5% of infertility, can affect both fertilization and implantation. The uterine factors can be congenital, leiomyomas, intrauterine adhesions, endometrial polyp, chronic endometriitis. And this is the normal development of the embryological development of the uterus. And these are the different ASTRID classification of genital tract abnormalities, like the dysmorphic uterus, the septate uterus, the bicorporeal uterus, hemiuterus, aplastic uterus. This is one type of classification, and this is according to the cervix also, this is how it is classified. Now congenital anomalies can be there also, which can lead to the infertility. They can lead to, they can cause other problems also, like the infertility in 2 to 4%, recurrent abortions in 10 to 13%, preterm delivery, implantation difficulty, and malpresentations. These are the distribution of specific congenital menorrhagia. This is the occurrence of septate uterus, biconvate, arcuate, uniconvate, and diadelphus. Most women with this anomaly have no difficulty in conceiving, but has an increased risk of mid-trimester lots. And the treatment may be metroplasty, but these days metroplasty is not recommended for any anomalies. Biconvate uterus, there is a deep indentation at the fundus. This is the indentation seen at the fundus, and the risk of term birth, preterm deliveries is there, and higher risk of the miscarriages and malpresentations. Then this is another type of abnormality, that is the arcuate uterus, where the uterus would be having an arc like this, a rise. This is the normal structure where the fundus should be height like this. But in arcuate uterus, there is a slight dimpling over here. There is no septate also. There is no septa, but there is slight dimpling at the fundus. And this is considered a sub-abnormality, but a mild type or a normal variant. Surgical correction is not recommended in this. Uniconvate uterus is when only one horn develops. So there is asymmetrical lateral fusion, one cavity with fallopian tube develops, where there is no horn. There may be a other horn also present, but this is communicating in this. There is a non-communicating type of abnormality also, or where there is a horn is there, but there is no cavity in this. So these are also abnormal types. Then there is a diadelphous type of abnormality, where the two Müllerian ducts fail to fuse and result in duplication of the system. So compared with the other uterine anomalies, uterine diadelphous has a relatively good prognosis because they are completely developed two horns. So they have a better outcome and complications, but still the complications like preterm delivery and fetal growth restriction and malpresentations are there. How do we evaluate the uterine abnormalities? One is by the history, as history is important in all types of infertility. So, and then the examination for the uterine type, we have the hysterosalpingography, the TVS and the sonosalpingography, hysteroscopy and MRI. Hysteroscopy is the gold standard these days, but hysterosalpingography is the most convenient because it is a OPD procedure and you do not need an anesthesia for this. And MRI if it is available and required SOS. So in hysterosalpingography, it is accurately defines the size and shape of the uterine cavity, provides clear images, and it can be seen by others also. Identifies the submucous myoma. Any intrauterine pathology will be identified in this, but the disadvantage is that extrauterine pathology cannot be detected. Intrauterine additions can be seen, endometrial polyps can be seen. If it is uniconate, you can detect it. Septate, subseptate and biconate uterus can easily be seen in this, and it divides into two horns. Like I'll show you the picture. This is the picture where of a hysterosalpingography where the uterus is slightly arcuate in shape. It does not have the normal fundal shape, but the dye is completely filling it. There is no defect here, and this is the tube which is lined, and this is the spillage at the pelvis. So myomas and larger polyps can be seen over here. If there is an irregularity like this, then there will be an intramural myoma. If there would be additions, then you would be seeing breakups in this and cavities as such. And if the tubes are blocked, you will be seeing no dye will be coming beyond the level wherever it is blocked. So you can see the level of blockage. This is another test which is also very convenient and OPD type of test. And here is the it complements the HSG and improves the diagnostic accuracy of differentiating between a septate and a subseptate uterus. And in a septate uterus, you will see a single unified fundus that is often somewhat broader and than the normal, and sometimes it is slightly concave. Biconate uterus has two entirely different cavities, and three-dimensional ultrasonography can generate reconstructed pictures. And this is the best, the 3D sonography is best these days, and this can be detected by this. Whereas, as I have told you, hysteroscopy is a gold standard because it can be operative as well as diagnostic, and we can do it in this manner in the same sitting. Treatment I will tell you is this, or we can take in the next class the further details of diagnosis and management of infertility as per the cause of infertility. Thank you.